A 21-year-old tradition in Vermont. Invite the world's best snowboarders to the U.S. Open. And may the best man and woman win. Last year, Kelly Clark followed up her Olympic halfpipe gold medal with a resounding victory. While the kid from Jersey, Danny Kass, took home his second straight U.S. Open title. Today, can hometown hero and Olympic gold medalist Ross Powers kick some Kass? The crowds are huge, and so are the tricks. It's the U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships, coming at you live.
Beautiful March day here in Stratton, Vermont. Perfect conditions for the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. Hi, everybody. I'm Craig Hummer joining you live once again on OLN. Last night, under the lights, it was the rail jam competition that started our weekend off. But today's event, the half pipe, will undoubtedly crank it up a notch. It's been the marquee event here at the U.S. Open since it was first introduced way back in 1988. You want an idea of how much prestige is on the line? Here's a good example. Five of the six 2002 Olympic halfpipe medalists have come here to Stratton in search of the coveted title, including two-time defending U.S. Open champion Danny Kass. For more on the event and the individuals, let's join my broadcast partners, GT and JMO. Take it away, guys.
Thanks, Craig. JMO and I are standing at the bottom of the U.S. Open pipe, and this is more like a rock and roll concert than it is a snowboard contest. And JMO, the format's a little different this year at the U.S. Open.
Oh, man, you know, you got it when you got a concert rocking as hard as this. Man, you got style as a key element. To judge style, they've gone head-to-head this year. Riders taking their style, taking their tricks, head-to-head elimination style.
Which is pretty sweet. Now, let's talk about the women. They're up first today.
Yeah, man, the women's field has exploded in the last couple years. The women are riding on the same level as the men now. Men might still go a little bit bigger, but the women are unloading back-to-back sevens, 900s, big spins, way above the lip. The women are rocking.
Well, we expect a huge competition here today. Women are up first, the men will join us later, and we're gonna do this hard.
Oh, yeah.
Most important, I think, to point out that this is an elimination bracket. The riders will go head-to-head. They will each get two runs, and the best run of those two runs will count overall. Three women and three men move on to the final round. We take a look now at the super pipe, and it's not called a super pipe for nothing. 120 meters long, but I think the most important stat to point out, the trannies, the transitions are 18 feet. The size of the transition directly relates to how much amplitude and air they are going to be able to get. And guys, when you talk about the U.S. Open, you have to talk about the crowds. There's a good look. They are amped. They have been forming all day long. You mentioned the women. They are up first. We are going to see those finals. Keep in mind that these crowds, you guys, have seen the semifinal action. They have seen a number of great runs so far.
Well, we that first bracket, JMO, we have Teter versus Burnes, two local girls. Hannah Teter being the young gun, and Tricia Burnes in the course right now being the vet.
Yeah, Trish Burnes has got her stock moves like that big spin 540 right there, backing it up with a backside Indy. That is Tricia Burnes' forte. She's got this stock, powerful run she has dialed.
And her body position was super quiet right there going to that front side 360, and then comboing it back into a faking 540 to finish strong.
Yeah, her 540s are her, like I said earlier, her forte. You gotta look out for those 540s. She's got backside fives, she's got frontside fives, and then there she was doing the switch five. So the switch five, why is that more technical than a regular five? Well, she's going backwards. So she sets up for that switch five with this 360, then comes into the switch five, nails it, has to wash around a little bit in the bottom of the tranny, but I'm still gonna slap Trish a high five because that was a pretty talented run.
Quiet style, she is a local girl, always competes well here at the U.S. Open, feeds on that crowd. Now this girl right here, Hannah Teter. She pulled a 900 at the X Games. She was the first girl ever to pull a 9 in competition, and she is only 16 years old.
Trish might have more competitive experience, but what Hannah Teter's got here is she's got airtime on her side.
Big, strong grabs right there for style points, but also control. And there's another front side spin.
Yeah, her body rotated all as one unit. So far, all of her tricks have been very flowing. Going for a 7. Oh, no, that was a 900.
And a very solidly landed 9. She landed it up in the transition, but did not have to skid through.
The irony is it looked like she was going for a 7, and then threw that 180 around at the last second.
Those fresh young legs in this 900, JMO.
Look at that. She just, she almost struggles a little bit too much to bring it around. I'm almost thinking she might have stuck with the 7 to have the flow of the 7 match the rest of her run, because she had to huck it a little bit there at the end.
She just got that last kind of 180 through, though. Landed in the bottom of the transition. And right now, with a head-to-head format, I'd have to give the advantage right now to the 16-year-old Hannah Teter.
If Trish Burns right now can link together her 540s and stick a switch 540 like she was trying to do on her first run and keep it all flowing, and she didn't come up short, she could maybe push Hannah Teter out of the way. Right now, though, no doubt Hannah had the better run.
Well, all about amplitude, style, the combination from wall to wall, and it's an overall judgment on behalf of the judges. So really, you kind of got to piece everything together.
Now, speaking of one of those judges, the judging criteria, you're just talking about style, okay? Style is such an important element in snowboarding. The goal is not to do the trick as same as the next guy or girl. So, style, what does it incorporate? It means quiet spins, quiet upper body, getting the grabs, keeping your body under control, making it look like if you didn't have bindings on your snowboard, it would stay on your feet. That is the goal of style.
It's all about making it look natural. Now, Tricia has her work cut out for her. She had a very respectable 29.1 for her first run, but unofficially right now, I tell you that Hannah has the edge, so she's really gonna have to take it up a notch in her amplitude and stick her tricks.
Into her backside wall, Trish Burns, boom! Perfect stylish backside air. Throws it into that 540, whips it around to a 7.
Bring it all the way to
back to back.
And the important thing to note here is she changed her line. Whoa!
The switch air, she's mixing it up all over the place, and then cabs out of that switch combo.
And then a tail grabber right there. The thing is, the judges have known Trish's line for the last 3 years. This is a new line for her, which the judges will know.
In fact, that was a fantastic run for Trish Burns. She threw the switch air in there. It was the switch combinations that set her apart right there from her standard run. That was not a stock run for Trish Burns.
Now this first hit, JMO.
540.
She gets the 540, and then that late last little 80, a little short on that 720 right there.
She holds her speed.
And that was the important deal. But unfortunately, if she's really going to get paid and make it on past Teter, she's got to land that up in the top, tail first. And that was a skid in.
Yeah, it's a tough call of what's going to happen. That run was pretty flowed and very articulate with the switch combos, especially when she went into the switch straight air. Trish Burns is right on the edge right now. I don't know what the judges are going to do. It's anyone's game at this point between Trish and Hannah, unless of course Hannah, taking her second run right now, can flow that 900. If Hannah nails that 900 with no sketches, it's going to be, hey Trish, I'll see you in the bar.
Well, speaking of edge, we also got to give a little props up. Not only is Trisha an exceptional snowboarder, but she also is kind of the managing editor of Eastern Edge, which is a snowboard magazine specifically dedicated to the East Coast scene.
Yeah, I mean, Trish Burns getting a 31.7 is not going to move on.
But
yeah,
not moving on top of
She is a fantastic pro, though. There she is signing autographs. She is a great, great athlete for young ladies to look up to. Hannah Teter, this is a showboat run for Hannah Teter.
But right there, that walk right in to that 540. Well, fresh fish on the back wall. But you can see just the confidence, a big 9 right there. And again, she can do better by landing into the top of the transition, but she landed in nose first.
There it is, a seven. That was a showboat run for Hannah Teter. She's got the seven, she's got the 900. That could take her to the finals. Lucky for us, Tina Dixon is at the bottom. Hopefully she can catch up. There's a lot of crowd making lots of noise. I'd like to see Tina maybe get a chance to talk with old Hannah Teter about some of those big moves. Crowd's going nuts. It is a full-blown rock concert. Tina is down there, Greg. Get it on, Tina Dixon.
Hannah Teter, the local Vermonter, stepping it up, 540, 900, 720, all in one run. Now, do you realize that you just probably set record history here in the U.S. Open with the first women's 900?
No, I didn't, but that's really cool.
Well, how do you feel about being in front of your local crowd and going up to these finals?
That's what I'm doing so good for. I mean, I'm just feeling the energy and all my family's here, so it's awesome.
All right, for the fans, have fun.
Thanks.
Thank you, Tina. Well, Hannah Teter feeling the love from the hometown crowd. They're having fun out there, and so are we. We'll be back with more of the next heat after this.
The 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships are brought to you by Jeep, the most respected, honored, and heroic 4x4s out there, only in a Jeep 4x4. And by Burton Snowboards, the best in snowboarding since 1977.
Come and tell us that.
Y'all want to be a rock star.
Hey, man. With over 10 hours of music on one CD, the Philips Xpanium MP3 CD player will go wherever you go.
Official sponsor of your action sports.
The idea is to party.
You know it's growing, baby.
The idea is to party.
You know it, baby. Sexy baby.
The party starts at 21. Captain's orders.
Who got no glory?
Global Extremes has reached its last leg in Costa Rica, and the athletes are becoming physically drained.
My chest started feeling tight.
I slipped and smashed my face on the rocks.
And with a looming decision ahead,
I'm just getting tired of thinking about it.
Two more athletes will be eliminated. Find out which will go.
I think we're all on the same page as far as who it would probably be.
Global Extremes Mount Everest Forerunners of Adventure, presented by Toyota, Monday at 10 on OLN.
Welcome back to OLN, Stratton, Vermont, and the Halfpipe competition here at the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. The crowd just saw a great heat between Teter and Byrnes. Hannah Teter, though, a freakishly great 35.9 on that first run. So, gentlemen, we move on to our next heat between Zurek and Kjeldaas. Who do you see as having the edge right off the bat?
Well, Natasza Zurek has won this event in the past. She is actually a Canadian via Poland, a very strong rider. But now Brun Kjeldaas is also a very accomplished athlete.
Yeah, Brun Kjeldaas in the pipe right now. Got good flow. She likes to drift her tricks down the pipe a lot. She covers a lot of walls. She got that 540 off the top, getting her straight airs in right now. I know, yeah, we probably expect a big 720.
She usually does that big 7 the first hit in. So, but her run has become somewhat stock. Again, the judges kind of know what she's going to do in advance, generally.
Now, it's kind of interesting. Her run actually was really stock. I'm used to seeing her throw the back-to-back sevens. She didn't do the back-to-back sevens in this run. Maybe she was just trying to get one in the back. Who knows? You know, it's weird. Up at the top, she does roll in, does unload a 540, misses the
actually,
grab.
She gets that 7 without a grab right there.
Right.
She pours in with a 7, so she did her stock 7, but again, you're right. No grab right there, and just nothing really, in terms of the amplitude scale, there was just no wow factor in that run.
In fact, I know we can expect the back-to-back 7 from her in the next run. I think she just wanted to get one in the bag, because I've seen Stine unload way tougher runs than that. Now, especially, she's going against Natasza Zurek. Now, the thing to look for from Natasza is she is a small, compact little human. She always gets her tricks landing right on the top of the vert, but she's also got a crippler. Look for an inverted crippler from Natasza.
And the thing about Natasha's riding style as she comes in, right there, gets a big twist, second hit right there. And the judges always like to see risks taken at the top of the pipe, because if you fall at the top of the pipe, it pretty much ruins your score for the rest of the run.
Yeah, she had a perfect 540 in there too with the grabs. She's got stylish grabs and all the tricks so far. There's the crippler.
To finish strong.
Crippler right at the bottom. That's a hard one to beat. You got the big spins at the top, the perfect grabs on every trick, and then their signature crippler at the bottom. Natasha's are going off.
And Natasza has that quiet squat riding style.
I mean, here she comes in the bottom, boom, the crippler gets the grab, lands it perfectly on the tranny.
And just look at how casual she was riding out of that. It was just another day at the office with about 3,000 people looking
just
on.
Boom, pops the lip, checks her landing, comes down like she's done it 10,000 times.
And how, I mean, again, I can't comment enough, how casual was that run for her? That was a full-on skate style from Natasza.
Yeah, the style factor was high there. No wiggling, no twisting. She wasn't fighting her spins. Got all of her grabs. Exactly what the judges are looking for. Speaking of winners, last year, Kelly Clark took this event, followed by Trish Byrnes and Stine Brun Kjeldaas.
Well, and last year, Kelly Clark pretty much destroyed every pipe contest she entered. Now, she is coming up a little bit later in the next bracket. But right now, all eyes are focusing on this Stine Brun Kjeldaas versus Miss Natasza Zurek matchup.
Yeah, both of them red hot rippers, and they snowboard good too.
Okay, at the top of the pipe, here we go, pouring into the U-ditch. It is Stine Brun Kjeldaas. Now, she is a former European, I believe, ISF world champ, if I'm not mistaken.
I think that is correct. Now, Stina's gonna have to up it a little bit here. Boom, gets the grab.
Oh!
Disaster on the coping.
A disaster both figuratively and literally. Because a disaster is that skate move when you land on the lip and then roll through it. Unfortunately, she landed on the lip, lost all of her momentum. She's gonna try and gain, but that's what we're talking about. Taking risks in the top of the pipe can get you paid, but it can also backfire dramatically.
She knew she had to go for it, though, because she saw Natasha's first run. Stine knew that she had to go for that big 7 right off the top. Disaster lip smack at the top, loses all of her speed, pops the lip, gets the grab, goes around trying to maybe get it to 7. And like Greg just said, it's called a disaster, figuratively as well physically, because it is a skateboard trick where you slap the lip on the way back in. But it was definitely a disaster there for Stine.
Well, the cool thing about Stine is she is a vet. She's been around the snowboard tour scene for, gosh, going on 8-10 years now. And the one thing that she's going to be remembered by, if nothing else, that smile. You can never go wrong with Stina's smile.
She is definitely one of the finest competitors out there. She is a great winner, and she also is really good at handing the crown over to somebody else. She is always there for all of her friends, all of her athletes, always got a smile on her face. Definitely a lot of athletes out there could learn something as far as sportsmanship goes from old Stine.
And that second run was a disaster. It was a 15.5, so she's going to keep that 31, but unfortunately, that is not going to take out Natasza Zurek.
Yeah, this is a showboat victory lap here for Natasza Zurek.
Yeah, so her first run was a 32.3. She's already moved on to that final three, so let's just see if she's going to try and unleash in the East.
Yeah, the thing that's kind of cool about a victory lap is it's just almost like she can practice the run that she's going to do in the next round. So we'll kind of see what happens if she busts out anything unusual. Stock airs at the top, twist there's right
the,
there.
Missed the grab that time.
1,000 times.
Ooh, a little open right there on that five.
Slow rotation was kind of slick, though. I'd like to see her cripple her again. I hope she goes close to the bottom because she's really got it wired.
But to contrast that first run, you see how she's... Whoa! She went crippler 7 right there.
Yep, crippler 720. She took that victory lap and brought out that crippler 720 at the bottom because she knows she's testing it because she's going to need it in the next round.
So up in the top, she throws down the McTwist. This time, though, she didn't get the grab. She opened up a little earlier, and then in the bottom, J-Mo.
Pop the lip, gets the crippler, throws the last 360 around to turn it into a 720. Unbelievable. I mean, you just cannot go wrong with a crippler 720. That's something that could easily take her to the finals.
Absolutely. Well, it did take her to the finals. Well, actually, her first run took her to the finals, but that one just put an exclamation point on it, and it also served notice to the competitors that she's going to face later on.
Well, when I say finals, I'm talking about the big money round.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, now speaking of cripplers, let's go down to Tina Dixon. She's with Natasza right now.
All right, Natasza, you're all about having fun. Tell me how much fun you're having here at the Open today.
I'm having so much fun. The pipe's awesome and it's soft and I'm feeling good about my riding.
Yeah, stepping it up with the crippler 7. Are we going to see that in the final?
Definitely. I hope I can land it.
All right, good luck.
Thank you, Tina. That crippler 7, crippler combo, it's all there. Natasza Zurek from Canada will move on to our final. Remember, three women will make it to our final round. Who will be the last one? We've got our final heat coming up. Stick around, it's next.
For years, there's only been one.
Attention all smokers. Now you can kick the habit in just 7 days. That's right, you can quit smoking easily in only 7 days guaranteed. Introducing the all-natural Smoke Away system, the herbal stop smoking program that works to help completely stamp out your nicotine cravings in just 1 week. Fed up with expensive patches, prescriptions, and gums that often don't work? For less than the price of all of them, you can stop smoking in 7 days, 100% guaranteed, or your money back.
It's safe. It's highly effective. I've had tremendous success with my patients using the Smoke Away program.
I like the fact that Smoke Away is all natural, and it really works.
I did Smoke Away for 3 days, and I've been smoke-free ever since.
The secret is the unique combination of all natural herbal ingredients that work to completely and naturally eliminate your body's craving for nicotine. Why spend hundreds of dollars on patches and gums that just put more nicotine in your system? For less than the price of any of them, you will stop smoking in 7 days, guaranteed, or your money back. Pick up the phone and order your Smoke Away system now. Smoke Away makes a great gift.
March on OLN, on Global Extremes Mount Everest, tensions rise. As athletes get closer to their goal and must eliminate more team members. Then, the U.S. Open of Snowboarding live. Watch Olympic gold medalist Ross Powers and Kelly Clark air it out, competing with the best in the world. Perry Neese returns, along with a dazzling duo of Paul Sherwin and Bob Rowe, to launch our cycling season. And the PBR keeps on kicking. March on OLN.
Welcome back to the Halfpipe competition here at the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships in Stratton, Vermont. And if you are watching at home, which we hope you are, don't adjust your TV because this is for real. This is a special heat we've got coming up next. The defending champion, Kelly Clark, going against the hottest woman in snowboarding right now, Gretchen Bleiler.
Kelly Clark going into the pipe right now. She won this event last year. She won an Olympic gold medalist. She is a monster.
Yeah, what she's got is power. Look at those airs are just huge. She almost stalled that 7 right there. Throws it into a 5. Unbelievable. Into a 7. Landed switch. Losing a little bit of speed. She almost ran out of half pipe.
She was a little out of control on that final 7, which threw her super down the pipe rather than vertically up and down the wall. And that's why she ran out of the pipe there on that last hit.
Yeah, it was really interesting. Kelly Clark, the Olympic gold medalist, you know, she was going so fast off those first two hits. She had two huge, powerful straight plate air. Big amplitude, powerful style, got the grab, but it's almost like she just drifted too far down the pipe and she ran out of pipe for her technical moves.
I mean, that frontside air was easy 10 feet out, but this is the one she went really long instead of up, and that has a lot to do with this pipe being on a pretty steep slope. It's on a 17 degree angle, the slope itself, so it's a pretty fast pipe as you come down it.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. That's not the run that Kelly Clark wanted. I mean, she just ran out of half pipe. She drifted too far. Now, Gretchen Bleiler, she has just been ruling it. She won.
She's won everything this year.
Oh, she's been going
nuts. Same way
that
Kelly won everything last year, Gretchen's won everything this year. X Games, any snowboard pipe contest you throw at her, this year Gretchen is at the top of her game.
And she's got a McTwist, a really perfect McTwist. Got to look out for that. She's got inverted sevens. Look at that, right off the top, a crippler.
Incredible.
Into a backside five. Come on. Oh, it's coming together.
Leg grab on that frontside five.
What an unbelievable.
Dive bombing an Indy right there, but look at the style and how quiet she's riding. Stretching out that nose right there on that front side. Elements of style right there.
That was flawless. That was a run that is going to be tough for Kelly Clark to beat. Right now, Gretchen Bleiler definitely taking the first runs there. I mean, look at this. It's incredible, right? She just comes in, gets the grab, perfect crippler. Whole trick happens above the lip. Look at this, pops the lip, gets the grab, opens up her body at the perfect time, connects with the vert, maintains speed into the next wall. Unbelievable, Greg.
We got a chance to see Kelly in that heat, guys. Let's get a chance now to get a little up close and personal.
Riding is so advanced right now. There's probably over five girls out there right now that can do nines. There's a bunch that can do cripplers, which is like a frontside wall invert. And they're linking tricks and amplitudes coming up. It's just been progressing, and it's really great to see, and it just makes me want to learn new tricks too.
Well, the pipe is packed. This is not a pipe. Let me correct myself. This is a super pipe. You can see the walls. They're about 15 to 17 feet high. That means that you can go big. And the ladies are delivering right now, J-Mo.
No doubt about it. Here's something to put into perspective, world out there. Snowboarding's one of the only sports where women compete on the same platform as the men. They don't use a smaller basketball. They don't play less sets in tennis. They don't swim a shorter distance. They're expected to do the same tricks as the men and ride the same jumps and ride the exact same pipe. Total equality. So maybe the rest of the world should get on board with snowboarding and run some, get some equalization going here.
We're all for equalization. Right here, Kelly Clark, if you notice, she plugged in her headphones. She always rides with the sounds in her ears. She's a punker. Let's see if she can deliver right now.
Carrying huge speed into her front side wall. Boom! Oh, opens up, missing the grab, landing way down in the tranny, forced to collapse. But the truth is, she came in with a ton of speed because she knew that's what she had to do to get a good run, and she had to go big.
Whoa! So you can see how big she went. She went so big, she missed the transition on the landing and actually landed in the flat bottom of the pipe.
She came in so fast on that first hit. You know, it's weird. What happened is she missed the grab, and that's actually what threw her all cattywampus.
No, and if you're a learned rider or want to become better, a lot of the times those grabs help keep your body quiet and composed in the air. Not only does it give you style, but it also allows you to float and hold.
No doubt about it. Kelly definitely not too stoked with her performance, not the runs she was looking for. But at this level of competition, the truth is you got to charge it. And we got to give Kelly high fives because she obviously was charging it. I don't know too many people are going to drop into a super pipe at 35 miles an hour and bust out a 10-foot air.
And right there, that was Stine Brun, who's already got cut earlier, given consolation to Kelly, because she knows right now that Bleiler is sitting on top right now. And this is a victory lap as well. She's already eliminated Kelly Clark, so she's into the final. And this is just Gretchen's kind of roll through. Now look, her first run was a 33.5. If you remember back in Hannah Teter, she had a 35.5. So right now, Hannah's run technically is a higher scoring run than Gretchen. So I wonder if Gretchen's gonna either turn it up to see what she can kind of add to it, or if she's just gonna kind of play it safe.
Now, I do have to say that as far as cleanliness and style and grabs go, Gretchen Bleiler has the back-to-back seven that she gets the grab and she dials it in and it's perfect. Where right now, Hannah Teeter's 900 is still a little bit hucked. I mean, look at the size of that crippler. She was like 8 feet out.
Look at how clean she is. Her body language, the way her balance, the way she stays centered over the board.
Yeah, it almost makes the tricks not look as hard as they really are. There it is. She's going for it.
She was going to try crippler 720.
Yep. She tried to do the same move there at the bottom as Natasza Zurek did, the crippler 720, which I think she will need if she wants to take home the big money.
The final spot in the women's finals. And everybody that
yeah, her inverts, I mean, her cleanliness is so unbelievable.
Yeah, she
look, she pops the lip, gets the grab, ready, opens up the grab.
Right at the top of the transition, maintains speed.
Unbelievable.
And then this bottom, if she gets that last little 180, she goes in fakie, and believe me, she will get paid. And at the bottom of the pipe right now, I believe Miss Tina Dixon's caught up with Gretchen Bleiler.
Now, you've won just about every contest you've entered this season. How much would it mean to you if you went home with the first at the U.S. Open?
Oh, I'd be so psyched. The crowd here is just awesome. My dad and brother came, my aunt, uncle, and cousins. And I just want to go out and have fun and hopefully do well.
Yeah, now we have some competition. Hannah's 900. What do you have to beat that?
I'm just going to try and go big, smooth, and get my crippler 7.
Yeah.
Yep.
Go get it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tina. Well, we will have that Teter 900 against the smooth style of Bleiler when we come back. Our final set for the women, Teter, Zurich, and Bleiler. Stick around, gang, because it's only going to get better.
Over 10 hours of music on one CD, the Philips Xpanium MP3 CD player was made to go as long as you can.
Available at Best Buy. Turn on the fun.
How to speak Australian. MVP. Beer. Foster's Australian for beer.
The Roman aqueducts have endured since 145 BC because of an engineering marvel, the arch. A curved structure so strong that even when great pressures applied to it, it holds its shape. Designed with such strength and integrity that modern man has yet to improve upon it.
Right now, look for special offers on the new Beetle at your local Volkswagen dealer.
It's a wonderful life. It's a lifestyle. If you've never had a burger cooked over an open flame, you're missing out on something.
Original Western Whopper is back. Crispy bacon and cheddar cheese with bullseye barbecue sauce. Hurry, this offer ends soon.
Mount Everest is so big, we had to put Global Extremes on 4 times a week.
All right, here we are then.
Twice on Monday, Tuesday, and Sunday.
Did I get it all though?
Watch the athletes travel the planet and compete to be one of the 5 finalists to climb the world's biggest mountain.
Reality is different.
29,000 feet.
Set your sights and head for the summit on the Outdoor Life Network's biggest event yet.
Yeah!
Good stuff.
Global Extremes Mount Everest for Runners of Adventure, presented by Toyota.
Welcome back to the 2003 Philips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championship, the halfpipe competition. We've got a little break in the action. We just saw Gretchen Bleiler advance. Right now, let's hear her thoughts on the U.S. Open.
The U.S. Open is definitely one of the biggest contests of the year. The best riders from all over the world come and compete. There's always an awesome super pipe and always a super good slopestyle course as well. It's always a good time. The vibe there is just so mellow. You know, people are there to have fun and just hang out and watch good snowboarding, and that's what it is. And just an all-around good vibe. A win at the U.S. Open is definitely something I would love to have. The best result I've gotten at the U.S. Open was 3rd place, and I was pretty psyched on that. Hopefully this year I can step it up a little bit. All around solid riding is really what it takes. Just, you know, some good spins, good technical spins. The US Open is going to be better than ever this year. It'll be going off.
Gretchen Bleiler up close and personal. Here you see our final three. The final heat will be Hannah Teter, Natasza Zurek, and Gretchen Bleiler. Of those three guys, it was Teter who had the best run, at least as far as points go, 35.5 GT. Is that nine going to keep her up top?
Well, I'll tell you, we were talking about it at break, that Teter definitely has that key 900 move, but Bleiler and Zurek both have better styles overall. So it's going to be a very interesting thing. Bleiler, I thought, was absolutely flawless in her run.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I mean, Bleiler was incredible. The style element was totally there.
And amplitude as well.
Right.
She did difficult tricks.
Oh, very difficult. Now, the interesting thing is there's a little bit of, a little bit of science going on right now with these riders, because it is the best of two runs in this final heat. So their poop run's going to get thrown out.
So they take their best score. They have two shots here. So you can pour in right now. Like Gretchen's going to go first here. She can pour in right now and just put it up. If it sticks, she's sweet. If it doesn't, she has another shot to take the top podium spot. Now, Teter, getting back to Teter, though, she has great amplitude. But that nine that she gets her big score move on is a little below the lip, to be honest with you. And that's the difference, because Bleiler's big money moves are well above the lip.
There is no doubt about it. She is above the coping, Gretchen Bleiler. Now look, when Gretchen drops in here, the question is she going to go for the big money run right off the bat, or is she going to stick one in the bag that she knows she can do? Is Gretchen Bleiler going to unload that crippler 720 at the bottom right now, or is she just going to do the regular crippler?
Now, just going in her mind, I say she goes for the 720. She was the last rider down this pipe, so she's still warm. Let's see what happens.
Into her front side wall. Crippler right off the front side wall. Big points when you bust a huge move like that into a backside 540, maintaining speed.
And then she goes right into another five, grabs on both. Back-to-back moves. The judges love combos between walls.
Oh, and there she goes. Flat spinning seven, carrying speed, runs out of pipe. She was ready to back that seven up, but ran out of half pipe. Similar to what happened to Kelly Clark, except, you know, Gretchen maintained it a little bit better.
Well, this pipe is 360 feet long, and it seems real big when you're at the top, but it sure comes up quick when you're done.
Check this out. Beautiful, beautiful 540 that she actually backed up really, really nicely above. And then, of course, you can't go wrong with a flat spinning 720.
No, and again, she lands all of her tricks up high in the transition to maintain speed. Now, this next gal, Natasza Zurek, she was on the Canadian Olympic team. She's won this event in the past, and she certainly has the ability to pull it out. She upgraded that crippler at the bottom of the pipe, turned it into a 720. So it's an inverted flip with a frontside rotation.
Yeah, no doubt. That's the question here is, like, you know, Gretchen Bleiler and Natasza Zurek almost have similar runs going on.
And Natasza styles.
Yeah, Natasza did unload earlier the crippler 720. That's sort of her big money move now. And she's got that McTwist going on, carrying lots of speed into the next wall. Beautiful frontside 540 with the grab, all styled out.
But really, it boils down to the nice dive there, that kind of tuck knee slob, dive bombing an indie. But the thing is, let's see if
there it is. Crippler 720. She had to throw her hand down for a tiny little wheelie bar. I don't even know if you people out there in TV world even saw that. But what happened is she came out of that crippler, and in the last 180, she had to slap her hand down. I guarantee you that the judges actually saw that. It's those little subtleties that are going to set it apart. Pops the lip. Boom. Watch her hand. Boom. Throws her hand down right there. The judges saw that.
That's noted. Also, she didn't get the grab on that McTwist either. She opened up, and that McTwist, that kind of inverted 540 up at the top of the pipe, that's a throw your shoulder down and tuck it down. And she really stayed open through it and didn't get the grab. So, again, not quite as styly and difficult as what we saw with Gretchen, in my opinion.
In fact, you know, I'm almost going to say that Gretchen and Natasha's runs were not the runs they were looking for, and I'm going to say both of their runs were actually about equal in the points scale. You know, it's hard to say really which one of them is.
I'm giving Bleiler the nod right now.
You're going to give Bleiler the nod.
All right. But here we go. It's all about the 16-year-old local girl. Hannah Teter is pouring in. Big frontside five to start things off.
Yeah, had the lean grab, really styly. Kicks out that middle backside air, goes into the nine.
A bigger nine this time, a bigger nine.
Yeah, still didn't get the grab on it, but the 900 flat spin like that's very difficult. Gets the
seven.
You know, the only thing that I would say that Hannah's run is lacking is linking some of those big spins together. Somehow linking a combination. The judges want a combo. In fact, I'm kind of curious to see what happens in this next round because Gretchen Bleiler has a fantastic combo. Hannah, she's got this big 900, and it, you know, hey, it is a 900 degree spin, but she doesn't get the grab and she doesn't combo it with anything. So where's the value?
Well, she has two big spins in her run. There's no two ways about that. However, it's just not quite as ampy overall.
We'll be back with the second runs from these ladies after this. More from the women's final on OLN.
Attention, state resident.
What we can do is talk about community. That would be a great idea.
I do too.
I feel like we really haven't connected in a really long time. We used to go places together. We used to do things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, every time I try to do something special, is all I get is garbage.
You've simply lost touch with something that was once good. You can't have it back.
Here, take this home.
Rekindle your love for the internet. Call 1-800-747-6491 and get 6 months of Earthlink dial-up for half price. You also get exclusive tools to keep the internet fun, like Pop-Up Blocker that gets rid of virtually all unwanted pop-up ads, and Spaminator, it helps reduce junk email. Guess it's no wonder we recently ranked highest for customer satisfaction among dial-up internet service providers, according to J.D. Power and Associates. Call, go online, or visit one of these retailers. Get 6 months of service for half price. Why wait? Move to Earthlink.
The new 2004 Jeep Grand Cherokee. So capable, you'll have to work hard to make winter driving a challenge.
Welcome back to the Halfpipe competition, the women's final underway at the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. Is it cold out there? Heck yeah, but on the course it is hot. Look at these scores from the first round. Gretchen Bleiler in the lead with a score of 36.4. And J-Mo, you said it before we went to break, those wall-to-wall combos have given her the lead.
No doubt about it. You know, it's like Hannah Teeter's 900 is huge. It's a big, powerful move. But she doesn't have it totally dialed yet. She doesn't get a grab. She's forced to kind of huck it around. She has to almost throw her arms up in the air like an ice skater, which is not a big style point getter here at snowboarding. Gretchen Bleiler doesn't use the 900, but she does have the cripplers and, you know, some linked 540s that are incredibly stylish, and she links it together. The judge is clearly giving more value to that. Gretchen, the current leader, this is the last set of runs right now. This is where it's all decided who is going to be the women's U.S. Open champion 2003.
Big crippler right off the top, taking a lot of risk right into that spin, and that's the combination into a third spin right there. Fletcher, Gretchen Bleiler has won the last 6 months she's entered, and right now, boy, she's
looking. Oh, there's the crippler, it goes into a 720. Unbelievable. Are the combos. Gretchen is so pumped. That is the combinations that make you a champion right there. I mean, I don't even know where to start.
Outstanding. The style right here, the risk at the top.
Gets the grab, sticks it. And look at this crippler, boom, upside down, then throws the last 180 landing switch, 720 degree crippler.
And again, that style, just rolling out of it. She was so confident, standing it up, rolling through the tranny, just like, what up?
Oh, so nice. Now, Interestingly enough,
Zurek has that Crystal
yeah,
7.
Zurek actually has that exact same run, of course, except with Natasza Zurek style.
Right, but that same trick. She doesn't start with the Crippler the way Gretchen does. So.
Yeah, she doesn't. So, you know, the truth is we hope to see some kind of move right off the top here. She's not. She can't do a straight air. Uh-oh.
It's not enough. Right
it's not enough. Straight air off the first hit and then missing the grab on the McTwist.
Yep.
Great 540 right there, though.
With the stale grab, which is super difficult to do. But again, she's not doing those real technical combos that Bleiler just did.
Yeah, Bleiler with the three big technical spins over the top. I mean, there's a Crippler, gets the Crippler 720, same move that Gretchen Bleiler did.
Same wall, same
but
hit.
I gotta say, Natasha Zurich's run was incredible, but she went a straight air off the first hit, and that's where it lost her the big points there. Not going for a big move right off the top.
Well, Bleiler just got a 38.2. That was her second run score. As we look at this replay, nice styly dive bomby Indy right there. But that ain't going to get it done. And hey, big ups on that Crippler 7 right there.
Yeah, high fives for Natasza Zurek. I mean, it's a close call. That was a fantastic run. But really, at this point, the judges are expecting a big move right off the first hit. If you're not unloading a big move right off the first hit, you're not going to get those booyah points.
It's a risk versus reward. You take the risk, you get the rewards. That 38-2 that Gretchen Bleiler just got was the highest score of the day. Hanna Teeters, her highest score of the day was a 35-5, which came in the elimination head-to-head round. She's currently sitting with a 33-7 from her first run. She is really going to have to match those combinations.
She's talking to her coaches up there, rocking out, getting her groove on, getting ready to drop in. First thing she's got to do, Hanna Teeter has got to do all of her tricks above the lip. She has got to do a big move right off the first hit. If she does a straight air off the first hit, I don't think she's going to be able to pull it.
And Gretchen Bleiler, our leader, like I said earlier, she's won the last six events she's entered, including the X Games. She had a 38-2 in her last run. Right now, Hanna Teeter has to better a 33 and some change in order to jump up to Gretchen's level.
Now, Gretchen's tearing it. And you know, the thing is Hanna has the skills to do it.
Absolutely.
She just, I'm just wondering what's going through her mind right now, because really, so hopefully one of the coaches told her what it's going to take. She's got to do a big move right off the first hit. And then she's got to link that 900 with something.
And Hanna comes from a snowboarding family. Both her brothers have competed in this event before. A big floaty frontside five, but right there, that kind of squatty sip right there off of that.
That's a marginal sip, but still, there's the 900 way up over the top. Can she link it? Oh, she's linking it. She wins the 900 with a 540, losing a little bit of speed. Gretchen Bleiler watching the run from the bottom.
Nice method right there, though. You got to give up for that final method. But I don't think it's enough, JMO.
You know what? I'm giving huge high fives to Hanna Teeter right now, because she used her brain. She knew what she had to do to knock it out, and she went for that run. Hanna Teeter went for the run she needed to get the win, and just a couple small bobbles, you can see the 900 was virtually, it was there. Lost a little bit of speed. She backs that 900 up with a 540, but a couple bobbles there by Hanna Teeter. She lost some speed, and that's where she lost it, but it's still high fives for Hanna.
And the psychology of sitting up on top is also difficult. Hanna Teeter definitely put it up today.
That's right, guys. We are going to come back and figure it all out. Who is our winner? Unofficially, it's anybody's game right now. Hanna Teeter, the local flavor, she wants the title. Will she have enough? We'll find out after this.
Yo, Method Man and Red Man here to show you how Power Strike from Right Guard Extreme works. Stop this strike with extra older fighters.
Let's pretend this huge elastic band is the Power Strike,
and these guys are older.
Let's see what happens when older meets the Power Strike.
See, it repels it for a new level of protection. Goes on clear, doesn't quit. Get more extreme. Get the Power Strike, dude.
Crown Royal on the rocks, please.
You know, they say when you're blind, all your other senses become heightened.
I think the one on the left likes me. new 2003 Discovery. It's a whole new way to see the world. From Land Rover, the most well-traveled vehicles on Earth. Nicely equipped from $399 a month. Complimentary schedule maintenance included.
The PER heats up on OLN. These bulls are tough, but our cowboys think they're tougher. It comes down to 8 seconds of heart-pounding action and fury.
All the bulls are ranked, so you gotta ride them one at a time, no matter if they're trying to jerk you down or eat you.
Looking for another world championship, the million-dollar man, Chris Shivers, is giving these bulls a ride for his money. Get ready, get set, get fired up. The PBR tonight at 8 on OLN.
It's bull riding, just wants to rough.
Tyler. Vermont in the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. The women's halfpipe competition is in the books. We have our winner. The officials have decided whose it's going to be. The crowd, they are anxious. They want to know. They are thousands deep here on Stratton Mountain, and it has been a fantastic competition so far. We'll see the men a little bit from now, but right now we're going to send you down to Tina Dixon, who is with our winner, Gretchen Bleiler.
All right, Gretchen Bleiler taking home the win today. Now, 1 year you didn't make it past pre-qualifiers,
no.
And then third place.
Yes.
And you won today. Did you ever find yourself in this position?
No, not at all. I'm so psyched, and I mean the crowd here is the best ever. And my dad and brother and aunt and uncle and cousins all came to see, so I'm so excited.
Let's talk about the competition today. Hannah Teeter's throwing down a 900. Yeah. I mean, you had some tough competition. Natasza doing an inverted 7.
Oh, yeah.
You're doing an inverted 7.
I mean, the level of riding for the women this year is off the hook. Everyone's riding so well. I mean, exactly what you just said. Natasha's doing back-to-back inverts. Hannah's doing 900. I mean, it's just awesome. I'm so psyched for everyone.
And you're a part of it.
I'm psyched.
Well, today was your day. Enjoy this.
Thank you, Tina.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Thank you, Tina. Thank you, Gretchen. Well, give yourself some props, GB, because that 3-in-a-row combo and the Crippler 720, as my compatriots called at the end, that sealed the deal. The 38.2, her final score, the best run of the day by far. And that gives her the win here at the U.S. Open, a coveted title for Gretchen Bleiler. GT, you said it earlier, she's won 6 contests, or had at least. Now it's 7 in a row. If there could be a poster girl of the sport, it would now be Gretchen Bleiler. She talked about the importance of the crowd here at the U.S. Open. Let's hear from our reporter, Darian Boyle, about just how important the U.S. Open is.
Snowboarding is an expression session. Each rider has their own individual style. Style? Yeah, it's in the riding.
Please, the U.S. Open. Raise your hand.
But another way the riders express themselves is through the artwork on their boards.
This is my 4th pro model. Each one of the horsemen represents one of my old boards. Yeah, I'm psyched on it. In the base, done by Jagger and Burton. You got the horse's face with the lightning bolts that are on it. Burton and the RP.
You're pretty much a headless business guy to turn any kid or man into a businessman on the spot right here.
A combination of, like, he does a lot of faces, and I really love stars, and I wanted to incorporate the stars into my graphic. And so he came up with this, and it's really awesome, and I love it.
This guy here just kind of made me a badass by himself. And then you take the board and you turn it around, and see, it makes the skull that comes down here. Here's the eyes. The base is just sick. It's just a nice kind of die cut of the same guy. It's kind of misty.
Sculptures, canvas, film, paintings, and even snowboards. All an expression of individuality.
You hit on it, DB, individuality. If there was a Miss Universe of snowboarding right now, it's Gretchen Bleiler, without a doubt. The crowd loving what they have been seeing by far. We're gonna have the men coming up a little bit later on. More from the U.S. Open after this.
What are you waiting
for? The best show on television is on FX. The Shield, Golden Globe Award winner for Best Drama Series. Golden Globe and Emmy Award winner for Best Actor Michael Chiklis. Hailed by critics as the best cop show on TV. Now, The Shield is back for a second season. Bigger, badder, better than ever. The Shield, Tuesdays at 10 on FX.
Our neighbor's truck
was sitting on top of the house.
The power.
The wind was so strong.
The fury.
Unbelievable!
The drama.
It looked like the scene out of a movie.
It's not a movie. It's Storm Stories, a new series, only on the Weather Channel, weeknights at 8 p.m. Eastern.
There's three lives that can be saved. We're definitely going to go.
Brace yourself. Weeknights at 8 p.m. Eastern. It's Storm Stories, only on the Weather Channel.
Bro, train the lizard.
Right. Sweet.
Hey.
Hi.
Tastes great.
Yeah.
Feels even better.
Wow.
Man, I think you're trying too hard. So be yourself.
So be you. So be me.
OLN's 2003 cycling season gets an early start with Paris-Nice. Exclusive live coverage every day. Crank it up as the U.S. Postal Team competes against the world's best in the race to the sun. Paul Sherwin and Bob Roll cover this prestigious event from start to finish. Watch daily, March 9th through the 16th, only on OLN, the Outdoor Life Network.
Welcome back to Stratton, Vermont. Craig Hummer along with GT, JMO, Tina Dixon, and Darian Boyle. The U.S. Open is well underway, guys. GT, JMO, we just saw a fantastic women's final, didn't we?
Well, it was a super pipe contest today. I'm all about female empowerment. And Gretchen Bleiler, if you're a boy, you do not want to follow her down the pipe right now, because she absolutely rocks it.
You know what the funny thing is when you say empowerment, that means somebody is giving them the power, but no one's giving them the power. They're just taking it. So there's no empowerment.
You're
they
right.
are just taking control. And the great thing is, too, what we saw here, we saw what the judges are looking for, because Hannah Teter had that big 900. She had the biggest move of the comp. But the 900 by itself isn't really gonna do it. The judges were looking for combinations. Gretchen Bleiler had the combos, so we can expect to see that in the guys' comp as well. Here, Gretchen Bleiler getting ready to show off some of her combos.
Subtleties as well as the grabs, the bigness, and like you said, the wall-to-wall combos.
Yeah. Let's throw it down to Tina Dixon. She's got some info. Tina, take it away.
What can I say? We just witnessed one of the best halfpipe contests in the world. Here at the U.S. Open, the women were on fire. Hannah Teter stepping it up with the frontside 900 in front of her hometown crowd. Only 16 years old. Natasza Zurek, two-time winner, coming back with a Crippler 7. But today was all about Gretchen Bleiler with the Crippler. Crippler 7, a person that didn't pass pre-qualifiers 1 year, comes back every year and is finding herself in a position she never thought she would ever find herself in. And that's what the U.S. Open is all about.
Thanks, Tina. A great story indeed. Here we take a look at the men's bracket, guys. Shaun White going to go off in that first heat against Daniel Franck. That's going to be a tough one, isn't it?
That might be the marquee draw right there. White representing the new school, Franck representing the OG rulers.
Yeah, it's going to be nuts, Craig.
JMO, we'll come back with that heat in a little bit. Right now, another break. It'll be Shaun White and Daniel Franck right after this.
How to speak Australian. Conservationist. Beer. Foster's Australian for beer.
Listen up, lugnuts. Pop quiz time. What happens to an engine with too much friction? I'll tell you, it loses power. So you want to reduce friction, right, Tinkerbell? This is new Quaker State. And engineered to deliver a 10% lower coefficient of friction. In other words, it's even better than before, because too much friction... Touchy little gearhead, ain't he? Nice haircut. New Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. What more do you need to know? Hey!
For me, it's gotta be real. You can't fake the taste of food grilled over an open fire.
Original Western Whopper is back. Crispy bacon and cheddar cheese with bullseye barbecue sauce. Hurry, this offer ends soon.
The 2003 Lincoln LS V8 and BMW 540i recently went head-to-head in a series of handling tests. The result? The LS V8 out slaloms, out corners, and has better handling performance than the BMW 540i. Lincoln LS V8 has shown 41,700. LS V6 starting at 32,495. There are those who travel and those who travel well.
Every Sunday night, join the big boys and get some no-dull action. It's Bull Mania, the best of the best. Pure athleticism and raw attitude of bull riding that can only be seen right here on OLN.
And that dude is a scatter cat, shoot from the hip, shotgun, bad cats to ride.
Bull Mania, Sunday nights at 9:30 on OLN.
Welcome back to Stratton, Vermont. A shot there of some of the beautiful scenery here in Vermont. But this time of year, the beauty is all about the half pipe and the snowboarding action. Here we are, the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. The women's competition is in the books. It is now time for the men to strut their stuff. We hinted at it a little bit before the break, guys. This first heat, this could be the marquee matchup of the day. Shaun White against Daniel Franck. Give me some thoughts.
Well, I'm going to just say it from the top. Whoever wins this heat wins this contest. How about that for a call?
It's, you know, that's I'm with you on that. I mean, we do. The field is really interesting. You know, Daniel Franck has probably been in more U.S. Opens than anyone in the final.
Absolutely. He's a former silver medalist at Nagano.
Yeah, Daniel Franck definitely goes off. But Shaun White is, he is the million-dollar little boy. I mean, $20,000. Shaun White's just like, well, I could use an extra 20, maybe.
And Shaun White has been winning everything. Not only last night, he got second in the rail jam. He won the X Games both slope and pipe. I mean, he's finally hit his stride.
Yeah. Now, the only thing that I'm going to say holds Daniel Franck back from getting Shaun White right now is Daniel often pops the lip too hard and lands low in the flats. That is Daniel's weirdest thing. He's got a really interesting crippler as well that he's developed. You'll see it because I'm sure he's going
to
use
it.
He has to use it. And it's this really obscure alley-oop inverted backflip 720.
Well, Daniel comes from Norway, and he ushered in that whole real techie spin in the pipe. Just, I mean, whirling tornado right there on a big McTwist.
Yeah, right off the top, the alley-oop 360 into the McTwist. He's setting up right now. Boom! Inverted 900. Come on, back to back 900.
One inverted, one flat spin.
That was the run that Daniel Franck was looking for. You
Absolutely.
Can see how pumped he was. That insane inverted 900 links it, the combo with another 900, back-to-back 900s with his classic backside alley-oop off the top hit. Oh.
I mean, he just uncorks that.
Way inverted, upside down.
And then into a front side rotating nine with the leg grab.
And the cool part is he mixed it up. He did an inverted nine and then a flat spinning nine.
And the
combo.
Note that.
Oh, the judges have proved by what they did by giving Gretchen Bleiler the win that the combos are the essential separator that's going to take the champion and make that person the champion. Daniel is stoked. That was one of the best runs I've seen Daniel do in a long time.
And Daniel also knows that he is facing the most formidable adversary in snowboarding pipe contest right now. And here he comes. This is the pirate himself, Shaun White.
Prepare for just about anything. Off the first hit, 900, flat spinning with a boned out big twist like he's
not even trying. Look at the rotation, total control.
And how big is he going? Oh! Uncharacteristic. When was the last time you seen Shaun Whitecase? You're speechless, J-Bob. Caught you.
Seriously, somebody should go out and try to find the t-shirt that says, I saw Shaun Whitecase the coping, because that never happens.
I've never seen that.
Unbelievable. That run. Shaun, I think, was even surprised because that run at the top, Daniel was definitely sweating in his boots. I mean,
how's
off the first hit? Hello, boom. You see him extend his leg on that McTwist.
Stop points.
And then, boom, look at the slow rotation. Body, arms, board, all moving together. He doesn't even need bindings.
How quiet is his positioning as well? But there's that sprack. He kind of went out over the deck. Didn't suck it back in and cased it on the way down.
Yeah, it was funny. I almost can't believe it. That fall is going to cost him.
We're going to find out what that first run score for Shaun Wright is after this. They've got one run each. When we come back, Shaun Wright, Daniel Franck squaring off yet again.
Come tell us that y'all want to be a rock star.
Hey, man.
With over 10 hours of music on one CD, the Philips Xpanium MP3 CD player will go wherever you go.
The new 2004 Jeep Grand Cherokee. So capable, you'll have to work hard to make winter driving a challenge.
How to speak Australian. Devotion. Beer. Foster's Australian for beer.
Listen up, lugnuts. Pop quiz time. What happens to an engine with too much friction? I'll tell you, it loses power. So you want to reduce friction, right, Tinkerbell? This is new Quaker State. Engineered to deliver a 10% lower coefficient of friction. In other words, it's even better than before, because too much friction... Touchy little gearhead, ain't he? Nice haircut. New Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. What more do you need to know?
You know, it's a wonderful life. It's a lifestyle. If you've never had a burger cooked over an open flame, you're missing out on something.
Original Western Whopper is back. Crispy bacon and cheddar cheese with bullseye barbecue sauce. Hurry, this offer ends soon.
No God, no glory.
Global Extremes has reached its last leg in Costa Rica, and the athletes are becoming physically drained.
My chest started feeling tight.
Oh, I slipped and smashed my face on the rocks.
And with a looming decision ahead...
I'm just getting tired of thinking about it.
Two more athletes will be eliminated. Find out which will go.
I think we're all on the same page as far as who it would probably be.
Global Extremes Mount Everest Forerunners of Adventure, presented by Toyota, Monday at 10 on OLN.
We are back once again to the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open, the men's halfpipe competition underway. You can see the crowd is into it. They have seen one good run each from Daniel Franck and Shaun Wright. We get set for their second run, guys.
Well, I have to comment really quick. I've seen polar bears, chickens, funny hair dudes, guys in trees. The Vermont folk love this event, and so do we. The whole community turns out. And when we said at the top of the show, this is like a rock concert, it really is. I mean, what a cool scene.
Out here in Vermont, there's a lot of woodwork, and they're coming out of it.
Now, interesting, you know, that we saw Shaun take a fall. I'm wondering if the psychology of Daniel going first and Shaun had to kind of stew on it for a little bit, and also Daniel's first run score, a 33-1, a little low.
Yeah, I mean, I'm questioning is it because Daniel did miss the grab on one of his 900s?
On that inverted spin?
And maybe the big drifting backside alley-oop off the first hit for Daniel, maybe the judges were looking for something. Yeah, maybe it was too stock. Daniel also set up for his 900 combination by a gigantic blind floating air to fakie.
Which we've seen for years.
That's a signature move.
If he floated off into the stars, which he will, and he does, but he will be remembered for that air to fakie. Daniel's air to fakie is unparalleled. But it is also the psychology of Daniel going first down the pipe and the judges leaving some room for scores.
Yeah, it's really weird. I thought Daniel should have gotten scored bigger. I know Daniel's going to bust it out even harder right here.
No, he has nothing to lose now.
Let's see what happens. Boom, there's the backside.
How big was that?
Alley-ooping, perfect grab into the McTwist. Holds the grab the whole way through the rotation. Oh, that is so huge and so difficult. And there's his movement. He sticks
it. Got it in. Into the flat spin. Nine right there with the grab.
His quadrupler 900 into the flat spinning 900. That is the run he wanted. So powerful. Daniel Franck is pumped right now.
The only thing I could be critical of is that bigness of that air to fakie. He landed so far down in the transition that he didn't have a lot of speed to go into that crippler 9.
Look at the air to fakie.
How's the setup? Now look at how low he landed.
But he carries his speed. He lands low, but he carries his speed. And here he is, totally inverted 900, directly upside down, spinning in the upside down, backs it up with another 900. Big scores.
Kids at home, how was that combo? Whoa, there's the gorilla. There's the chicken. Watch out, Daniel. The chicken versus the gorilla. What came first, the chicken or the egg?
Look, the chicken is taking her on at Daniel. Daniel doesn't have enough competition with Shaun White.
Let's hear what Shaun White had to say after his first run. He has saw what Daniel Franck had done. Now he has seen what Daniel Franck has done in the second run. We're gonna hear from Shaun right now.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. Shaun White has his work cut out for him right now because Daniel raised the roof.
Just doing the contest that I want to do now is so much nicer because I get, you know, more free time. I actually got to just ride this year, and I haven't really been able to do that much for the past couple of years just because contests and photo shoots and all that stuff. But I've been able to ride this year, and it's been so much fun because I just got to learn new tricks, and I just got to, I don't know, make better runs. And I'm really getting into slope style and rails and stuff like that now. So, you know, it's like this whole other side of, you know, whole other side of snowboarding that's just kind of opened up. So.
Shaun White is a dangerous 16-year-old. He has the skills for the future and here and now.
Yeah, you know, the only thing that could stop Shaun White's roll to the top, I got to quote Todd Richards, one of the greatest halfpipe riders ever, when I say the only thing that can stop Shaun White now is a girlfriend.
Or Shaun White himself, yeah. Which could be a girlfriend.
Yeah, I mean, Shaun is only 16. He is so talented on a skateboard and on a snowboard. I don't even know why he bothers to use bindings. And that is one of the things about a snowboard. You can tell that the style and the tricks are there. Is like when the rider is riding so well that it looks like they don't need bindings, then you know they're ripping.
Well, Tina's down at the bottom right now with Daniel Franck, and let's see if we can catch up with those two. But I'll tell you, was Daniel's second run better than his first, JMO?
I'm going to give it to Daniel Franck that his second run was definitely better than his first. Tina Dixon, he's down with him right now. Let's get some inside scoop. Drop some shade,
and we can also use. All right, Daniel Franck stepping it up in that final run. Now I have to ask you, were you feeling some pressure from the young Shaun White?
Yeah, I mean, I started off, I had to meet Danny Kass. That was tough enough, and when I squeezed him out, to put it in that word, then it was definitely not easier with Shaun White. I mean, he's basically been winning everything he's entered this year, so the pressure was definitely on, so I had to do something to get a better score.
Now, you've been coming to the Open for a while now. How has it changed over the years?
The progression is amazing, you know? Like, I mean, if you're away for a year, it's going to take you so much time to get back into the game. I mean, like all these kids coming up is amazing. Just look at Shaun. He's incredible. And he just turned 16. You know, where is he going to be at when he's 20?
Yeah,
it's going to be crazy. Yeah, probably.
All right, well, good luck next time.
All right, thanks.
All right, Tina, thanks again. Daniel Franck, two fantastic runs. We'll be back with more from the U.S. Open, our next heat, right after this. Stick around, gang.
for years.
Attention all smokers. Now you can kick the habit in just 7 days. That's right. You can quit smoking easily in only 7 days guaranteed. Introducing the all-natural Smoke Away System, the herbal stop smoking program that works to help completely stamp out your nicotine cravings in just 1 week. Fed up with expensive patches, prescriptions, and gums that often don't work? For less than the price of all of them, you can stop smoking in 7 days, 100% guaranteed, or your money back.
It's safe. It's highly effective. I've had tremendous success with my patients using the Smoke Away program.
I like the fact that Smoke Away is all natural, and it really works.
I did Smoke Away for 3 days, and I've been smoke-free ever since.
The secret is the unique combination of all-natural herbal ingredients that work to completely and naturally eliminate your body's craving for nicotine. Why spend hundreds of dollars on patches and gums that just put more nicotine in your system? For less than the price of any of them, you will stop smoking in 7 days, guaranteed, or your money back. Pick up the phone and order your Smoke Away system now. Smoke Away makes a great gift.
There he was. My heart began to race. Had too much time gone by for us? Then I saw a sign, and I knew that soon he would take me in his arms and tell me the words I'd been longing to hear.
Hey, Scones. Thanks, honey.
Introducing the V8-powered GX, the all-new luxury utility vehicle from Lexus.
Welcome back to the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championship. The men's halfpipe competition underway in the first heat. Shaun Wyatt unfortunately fell in that second run. So as Tina mentioned, it was Daniel Franck who would advance. And GT JMO, you guys said you really think the winner of that heat is going to win the whole thing, GT.
Well, Daniel Franck took down Danny Kass earlier, who also is a favorite. So Daniel Franck still is my odds-on choice. JMO, what's your thoughts?
Well, it's so hard to say because Daniel Franck could meet Andy Finch. Ross Powers as well, the Olympic gold medalist. Now, the thing is, Andy Finch, he's got a similar set of tricks to that of Daniel Franck.
They real both explosive do these off the lip.
Explosive,
yeah.
And crazy inverted upside down 900 spin variations. Watch that from Andy Finch. Just throws a big old crippler, and then he's into a McTwist. All the style is there. He's going to start unloading something bigger.
Lots of amplitude as
big
well.
720, backs it up with another 720.
Oh!
Now that was unexpected. Very unexpected right there from Andy Finch. He's severely disappointed.
The only good news for Andy Finch right now is he has a second shot at going down the pipe. But again, you can see that ampy style that we were talking about. A lot of pop off the lip.
Well, the irony is that I knew what Andy Finch was doing. Andy Finch at the World Superpipe Championships had a really interesting technique is he was unloading these back-to-back sevens, which he's landed 1,000 times.
He like healed out right there, yeah.
But you know what he does? After that back-to-back seven, he goes into back-to-back 900s.
Which is a macho combo.
A macho combo indeed. So right now, Ross Powers, he's basically like, okay, man, I can just put one in the bag here. I might even be able to just do my stock run. Now, believe it or not, a stock run for Ross Powers often includes a switch McTwist.
Now, the only thing about that stock run is the judges are very familiar with his run. Now, the thing about Ross Powers' position here, though, as you know, Finchie right now dropped out right there. So Finch is going to have to come back. It's up to Powers right now to make Finchie take it away from him.
Pat did Ross Powers.
That method
huge
right
method. Okay, let's look for the... Oh, man, that was a big frontside air. Okay, there's the big twist. Gets it all Japan-style bone down. Try more like a 900.
Oh, thank you very much.
Oh, stylish air to Fakie. Backing up for
switch
something.
McTwist.
Switch McTwist. Oh, there is his move.
And to a 7 to finish. Strong move. The one thing that we haven't seen is that 9. He upped the 9, up and into the 9.
You know, I got to say, Ross Powers put together a great combination there. That was a combination that he has not done too many times, so you got to surprise the judges. The judges want to see that. They want to see the riders, you know, unloading new things. Method air so big, you know, at the top. Yeah, 10 feet big. You know, that's such a stock thing for Ross Powers, but people want to see him go big. But then he unloads the 900, gets the grab, holds it for almost a complete rotation and a half.
Yep.
So sweet.
And he gets that late grab there. So Powers, a very strong run. Hometown favorite right here. Stratton is his spot. And that has to work to his favor as well.
Okay, Ross has got one in the bag now.
So Finch has to take it away from him.
Well, if Finch does the run that I think he's going to do, it's going to be pretty heavy on Ross. I mean, Ross's run was virtually perfect. The only place that he could have maybe gotten some more points was by busting out something really powerful off the first two hits instead of just straight airs. So if Andy Finch drops in, does a big spin or some big gutsy move right off the first couple hits, and then carries those combos all the way through, Ross could be heading to the bar.
Well, the good news is this is a very competitive matchup between Finch and Powers. Powers, you know, the other thing about Powers is he really rips hard and his style is so quiet that sometimes he doesn't get his just due.
Yeah, I mean, that frontside air that Powers unloaded, even though, I mean, hey, it was a straight air, but I mean, I don't think anyone has done a frontside air that big here today.
Okay, now Finchy is in the top of the pipe. He's pumped and truly, Finch is an animal.
Like,
he is a strong aggro rider.
Yeah, I mean, I would have to say, he's the only person I could really compare to Daniel Franck.
In terms of that just overall amp.
Yeah, that raw energy. Now, let's see it. Andy, first thing he's got to do is he's got to do a big spin off the first hit to grab a first handful of points away from Ross Powers. So let's see what happens. His first hit is going to dictate what happens. Boom. Crippler. There it is. He's already ahead of Ross right now with the big twist. Will he carry it through the bottom into a
seven?
He's going to do that run that we were talking about. Back-to-back sevens. Here comes the 900. Unbelievable.
Oh, he padded it a bit. Oh!
That is so tough to call. He passed the dog. He ran out of half pipe. He was going to do another 900, but he ran out of wall. The question is, he had no straight airs right on the cusp. I mean,
risks at the top of the pipe. We've been talking about it all day.
Boom. Crippler. He was ahead of Ross right there off the first hit. But the 900, where he comes in fakey and pops.
Well, that's the 720.
Here
comes the 900.
Here's the 900, that's right. And he gets the 900, throws a little ham pat, and then runs out a wall. I'll bet you anything he was going to do another 900. I can't even tell what the judges are going to do. It's too hard to call.
And he's talking to, right there, another hometown favorite, Kier Dillon, who unfortunately got eliminated earlier in the event. But I'll tell you, that was an explosive run by Andy Finch.
Incredible. I don't know. You know, that is so tough to call because Ross's run
was so quiet and powerful, man.
It was so quiet and so stylish.
So Ross's first run, a 36.5.
Yeah, Andy does not know what he has got yet. The score for his second run has not come out yet. But it is really, that is no telling really what's going to happen, you know, because Ross had those incredible, difficult technical combos like the switch McTwist. His run was a very interesting cornucopia of bizarre stunts, whereas Andy's run explosive, but yet sort of straightforward. You know what I'm saying? Andy's run straightforward.
Well, all I got to say is Andy had a clenched fist, Ross smoothied it, and got the backside air to stretching that method, and then again the extension on that nose bone right there.
That frontside air is incredible. Got the McTwist with so much style, throws it into a 900. The backside scalefish 360, very bizarre.
Into a switch McTwist, a different run than his first run, gets a big spin right there at the end.
Crippler,
that was Andy Finch looking on right there.
Look at him high-fiving each other. These guys ride together all year long. They're pros.
That was a dope contest run.
Look at Ross with the switch McTwist. Very, very difficult move. And then pops it into a 900. Fakie to fakie 900.
Another look, J-Mo.
So sweet on the switch McTwist. Carries speed. He's in switch position, riding backwards. Pops the clip. Flat
fakie
spinning.
To fakie 9.
Fakie to fakie 9. Oh.
Two great second runs, guys. Will it be Finch or Powers? The crowd doesn't know yet. We do not know show yet. We will find out when we return. One man will advance, another will go home. Who's it gonna be? Finch or Powers? Stick around.
And now the toughest leg of the strongman competition, Norm, the Bud Light Industrial Fridge Pull.
Jim, that's 1,000 pounds of pure hernia that they'll try to drag across.
Sorry to interrupt, Norm, but it looks like a fan from the stands has stolen the Bud Light. Oh! A huge hit from out of nowhere. And this guy's got the foot speed to take this thing all the way. Oh, man!
Come in, bro!
For the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down.
Okay, who's the hero?
Make it a Bud Light. Official sponsor of your action sports.
Hi, Joe.
Hi, FedEx guy.
Let's get to work.
So it can store up to 1,000 addresses. It lets you print labels and find a Dropbox. It can email you when the package has been delivered and more. FedEx.com is just like having your own FedEx guy. Hey. Yeah? Kind of freaked me out, man.
U.S. Open, here we go. I'm so stoked for this year's U.S. Open. It's going to be awesome. Everyone's pushing it so much. The guys, back-to-back tens, they're so into it. So much energy. And it's going to be live. Can't screw up. Don't screw up. It's live.
The U.S. Open of Snowboarding. Action begins Thursday, March 13th at 8 p.m. with live coverage Friday the 14th at 7:30, Saturday the 15th at 2, and Sunday the 16th at 2:30 on OLN, the Outdoor Life Network.
Welcome back to the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. We just saw two gladiators duel it out in the men's halfpipe competition. There is the man who will advance, Ross Powers and GT JMO. During break, you said you had to give him the benefit of the doubt. See that second run score, 38.3, because he got his full run in.
Not only did he get his full run in, he also added some different tricks in. So the judges were kind of familiar with his first run and did some new things as well, where Finch did kind of come up short.
Yeah, unfortunately, Finch at the bottom through that 900 came a little bit low in the bottom of the tranny and missed his last hit. That's where Ross got him. Ross had more hits, more tricks. Right now, though, dropping in, all eyes on this guy, Kazuhiro Kokubo, obviously from Japan. This guy has got style like you can't even believe. Watch the low body, the huge airs. That's the biggest McTwist I've seen in a long time.
And he's 14 years old.
900, so perfect. The style is unbelievable. Look at the slow rotations. So sweet, you know. I gotta say, Kaz's run right there was absolutely amazing in the style department. I'm gonna compare him with Shaun White's style. He did come up short on the last hit. He landed deep in the tranny. You didn't see him fall.
Sit back.
But when he landed deep in the tranny, it forced him into the flat bottom, and he missed his last hit. He actually had one more hit that he was forced to
step. How big is this McTwist, Jimbo?
Giant, about 35 feet down the pipe, 15 feet out, and then look at the grab, gets the Indy, bones it out on the 900.
And look at right there, just in between the walls, his body positioning, he was pointing it, he was ready to take on that next wall with balance and speed.
Unbelievable. Steve Fisher knows he's got his work cut out for him. This guy's on the U.S. snowboard team training for the Olympics coming up in Italy here in a few years. Steve Fisher's got the competitive skills, but he's got his work cut out for him when he's going up against the style factor of Kazuhiro Kokubo, that is for sure.
Fisher dropping into the ditch. Ollie's up over the hip, here he comes. Big backside five to start it. Oh!
Way low into the tranny, Steve Fisher. Fisher knows that that one cost him. Huge backside 540. Very basic move. He did do it off the first hit. Now, there's why the judges want to see a big, big move off the first hit. That's where you score points. Gutsy moves off the first hit. Steve went for it and paid the price.
Steve Fisher not going to count that one. He's got another run to go. It's Kaz Kokubo with the lead after one round. That is for sure. The 14-year-old has done it. Will he hold on for U.S. Open after this?
Attention.
Discover the truth.
Yes, I'm not sorry for it.
Relive the scandals.
He made the biggest mistake of his professional career.
Experience the confidential world of WWE.
The business to me is extremely personal.
Heart-wrenching stories, in-depth features, and controversial matches. World Wrestling Entertainment Fanatics Series proudly presents Best of WWE Confidential Volume 1, available all March on DirecTV.
Saturday and every Saturday, new hit movies premiere only on Stars. Premiering this month.
There's nothing more toxic than a human child.
That thing is a killing machine!
Help! You're doing a lot of laundry lately.
Just keeping it clean.
Death is too good for them. They must suffer as I suffered.
Why are you doing this?
Revenge.
Premiering Saturday nights this month only on Stars. One of 12 great channels in the Stars Super Pack on DirecTV.
OLN's 2003 cycling season gets an early start with Paris-Nice. Exclusive live coverage every day. Crank it up as the U.S. Postal Team competes against the world's best in the Race to the Sun. Paul Sherwin and Bob Roll cover this prestigious event from start to finish. Watch daily, March 9th through the 16th, only on OLN, the Outdoor Life Network.
Introducing Lincoln's newest luxury SUV, the 302-horsepower Aviator. A smaller, spirited offspring of Navigator. There are those who travel, and those who travel well.
Welcome back. The crowd in Stratton anxiously awaiting the last two runs before we know it is official who is in our final. Fisher against Kokubo. The super styling sensation from Japan, only 14 years old, guys. How does he top the 31-6 he had in the first run?
Well, he had the style elements, he had the bigness, but there was no real gnar.
Yeah, you know, what Kokubo, I think definitely what he needs is, man, little Kaz here, he's got to make sure that he doesn't drift too far down the pipe. He's missing out on about two walls. Yep. He needs to get two more tricks in. So he needs to somehow carry his speed up the tranny and up the pipe
and not go
down the pipe.
Exactly.
So let's see what happens. He's rolling into his frontside wall. A beautiful frontside air. Great style. Getting the grab. A gigantic McTwist. Now he's just got to control his speed a little bit. My goodness.
Big
look
nine.
At the size of that 900.
Oh, my backside method. But here's the thing. Did he get that last hit? And yes. He finishes with a seven. I'll tell you, that was an improvement that time.
It was. I mean, the crippler at the bottom. I mean,
that made the difference.
Yeah, he got the difference. Now, the only thing is he did not combo anything together. In comparison to the way that Ross Powers did the blind Stalefish 360 landing switch into a switch McTwist, an incredible combo. Here, he does a McTwist, but does he combo the McTwist is the question.
And you could see that size bar. He was up right around 20 feet out the top of that pipe.
Right, but then you see he backs up that 900 with a stock straight air. You got a combo. There's no combos. Great moves, but to take
back
home the big
back.
Money, he's going to have to develop a combo.
And that's what the judges are really looking for. They're looking for wall-to-wall combos, 720 to 900. or 7-7, 9-9, inverted spins to flat spins, those kind of combos to keep it interesting and also just add a little degree of difficulty.
Yeah, I mean, there's also the difference between he's only 14, you know? He's a young kid compared to Daniel Franck, who's in his mid-20s, upper 20s now. Daniel Franck knows how to win a contest. Steve Fisher, another guy who knows how to win a contest. I'm wondering right now if the U.S. coaches are actually telling Steve, look, Steve, you know, Kaz had a great run, but he didn't throw any combos together. So, Steve, don't forget to lay together some combinations, because if you don't, Kaz is going to the finals and you're not.
Now, psychology-wise, Steve is pointing, going, oh, God, man, I sat on my first run. I'm really going to have to hit it right here.
Rolls in. Backside 540 right off the top landing.
Deep in the tranny.
Sorry, 900
right there.
But he was deep in the tranny again.
Lost his speed.
Really wild. You know what? Steve right now.
His psyche, it's out of it.
He's lost his. Steve's bummed.
Mental.
He lost. He's super. I mean, he's bummed right now. He mentally lost it in there. I'm going to have to say right off the top right now that Kaz might not have had the combos, but Kaz just got lucky. Kaz is going to the finals.
Now, you got to give ups to Steve. But unfortunately, as he poured into that first hit, he went too deep on that first flat spinning 540, and that was it.
Yeah, he hit the bottom of the tranny, collapsed to his knees off that first hit. And once you like get that jolt and your flow gets kicked, it throws you off for the rest of the run.
Right here, that second wall, he was already kind of off his game in that big nine right there.
Yeah, I mean,
but
it's impressive that he threw a nine with that little amount of speed. But I'm going to have to say that Steve, you know, he had a great showing. He had a great showing, no doubt, here at the U.S. Open. But Kaz is going to the finals.
Kaz is in the finals. It is official. The unbelievable amplitude of the kid from Japan has put him up against Ross Powers and Daniel Franck. It's the men's final when we return.
How to speak Australian.
Oi.
Keeper.
Shall we?
Absolutely.
Beer. Foster's. Australian for beer.
Over 10 hours of music on one CD, the Philips Xpanium MP3 CD player was made to go as long as you can. Available at Best Buy. Turn on the fun.
It's a whole new way to see the world. From Land Rover, the most well-traveled vehicles on Earth. Nicely equipped from $399 a month. Complimentary scheduled maintenance included.
How to speak Australian.
Stop! 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 Bring her in!
Humanitarian.
Get him!
Beer. Foster's. Australian for beer.
Welcome back to Stratton. You see the bracket, our finalists set in the men's competition. Ross Powers, he won this title in 99. He's right there in the middle. Daniel Franck, he was a 98 in Nagano, the silver medalist in Nagano from Norway in the snowboard competition. They are both going up against the young phenom from Japan, Kazuhiro Kokubo. This has been a fantastic day. We've had two great days of competition, but certainly we're gonna round it off with some great styly action, guys. It's the slope style competition. That is what is going to be our next telecast here at the US Open. That'll be at 2:30 p.m. tomorrow Eastern time, a full 2.5 hours. Do the math, 150 minutes, all slam-packed action, men and women slope style.
Definitely going to be ripping. We've heard too that the weather is going to warm up a little bit, which is great for slope style because it gives the landings a little bit of cush. So tomorrow you can expect to see some of the finest hucking on the planet going down. The slope style course is insane. I took a couple runs through it. The landings are perfect. The slope style is going to go off. You do not want to miss it tomorrow.
And the cool thing about slope is it's the complete snowboarder that does well in slope. You got to be able to hit the rails, hit the jumps. There's sometimes quarter pipes in the course as well. Where the half pipe is a dope event because it is a snowboard specific event, the slope is what most of the kids who roll their local resorts, it's kind of what you do.
Yeah.
You know, it's all about slope.
Speaking of slope style, you know what they have in slope style? They have lots of rails. They got some huge, like 40 foot, 50 foot long rails up there on the course. And speaking of rails, moving forward from that, the other night we had the Under the Lights rail contest. The rail jam went nuts. Guys were blasting and undoing a whole bag of tricks that you couldn't believe. Going blind, going switch, and when it all came down, Greg.
Well, it's all about Travis Rice last night. He butchered this course using that step up ledge two different ways. Airing with that front side. Oh, that was Shaun White right there, who had a bit of a fall. He came in second, but again, Travis Rice was the man.
There we go. Those were the highlights from the rail jam last night. There you see the final results. Travis Rice, guys, as you said, 25.3, a full point ahead of Shaun White. Shaun with that second place, unfortunately, couldn't translate to that anything in the half pipe today, but he will be in the slope style tomorrow. Zach Leach in third, and we had that tie for fourth place overall. Right now, let's send it down to Tina Dixon, who's got another bit of info for us. Tina, what do you have?
Well, moving into the finals, we have an international field of riders. Daniel Franck from Norway, the veteran, stepping it up, keeping the level high. And then we have the young 14-year-old from Japan, boasting bigger than both Ross Powers and Daniel Franck. But don't cut Ross Powers short because he is on fire here. Gold medalist. Can he repeat the victory in 1999 here at the US Open? He's at his home mountain. We'll wait and see.
Thank you, Tina. He won the Olympics last year, guys. He's on a four-year run if he wins again this year, just like the Olympic gap. He took the 99 title. If he wins in 2003, that's that four-year gap everybody always talks about with the Olympics. So you think he's got enough to do it?
I think Ross definitely served notice to the judges and the crowd here today. He has some newness in his run, very flawless in his execution. But the point is this, and I said at the top of the show, whoever takes down Shaun White has the edge. Daniel Franck beat Shaun White in the first matchup.
Things to look for right now from Daniel Franck. One, he has got a habit of popping too hard off the vert, and he often finds himself landing low on the flat bottom. And he'll pull out of it. He's got legs of thunder. His legs are like these giant, like, off-road machines. He doesn't crash, but the judges will still dock him points. So he's got to stick to landing high on the vert, and Daniel Franck can do it.
Big floaty ollie oop right there with this. Oh, out of control going up that wall right there. Notice it. Uh-oh, he's gonna go for a rebate.
Okay.
He's unstrapping.
He is going for a rebate.
Pit crew, uh-oh.
Now,
what's he got?
This is so classic snowboarding right there, because Daniel Franck.
It's not on a timer.
Yeah, it's not on a timer. Daniel Franck dropped the ball on that area. He probably like jammed his heel side edge into some soft snow. So right now, this is called showboating. Daniel Franck's just doing it for the crowd. Busting huge backside. He's going
to
unload something.
Air to fakie setup.
Air to fakie setup, Greg. You called it.
Right there in the bottom of the transition. You see how low? He landed right where the transition meets the flat. And that not only loses your speed, but it's also brutal on your knees.
Oh, it is. Now, obviously, that was not the run that Daniel was after. Somehow, you know, it happens. It's just a little bit of bad luck. He came into that backside wall, a little heavy on his heel edge, and before transferring, when he was transferring weight off of his heel edge to go into a backside air, his heel edge jammed into some soft snow, and he dug his heels.
And I think it was further compounded because when he landed that alley-oop, that first big hit that he had, he was a little off balance, and I think that carried over.
Ross Powers.
Ross the Boss. Hey, that's his signature model from Burton right there that he's riding on. And let me tell you, last year when I was doing interviews in the crowd with all the kids, everybody's favorite rider in this crowd at the pipe contest is Ross Powers. Local guy, has a half pipe camp coming up next weekend here at Stratton. He is a man of the community.
The thing that Ross does, Ross uses his head in competition.
Outstanding.
He was ripping and had this stock run that he was using over and over again. The judges got too used to that run, so they started scoring him poorly on that run. Ross is like, well, all right, you don't like that run anymore? Take this run. He's been unloading this combination of stuff here that is unbelievable, especially the airs. Either does a blind 360 into a switch McTwist or an air to fakie into a switch McTwist.
I just think with Ross, that air of unpredictability will help him. And there's the big nine right there with the late grab.
900, here it is. Blind 360 into the switch McTwist.
Okay, now let's see what he gets right here. Not a grab.
You know, I'm slapping Ross high fives for that, though, because he definitely did a run that no one else is doing in a very obscure set of combos.
Yep.
That slow rotating blind
backside three.
360, yep. Landing switch, and then taking it
right
into
here.
A switch McTwist.
No, sorry, that's the McTwist right there. Stretching that out.
Rouse a regular McTwist. Now watch, here it is. Slow rotating, blind 360, coming in switch McTwist, bones it out, and then backs it up with another flat spinning 720.
Cases it, but rides through. Ross is definitely, and this group probably is the headiest competitor in terms of the strategy, knowing what it's going to take to win. He's won here before. Hey, he's won an Olympic gold medal. What else do you say?
Yeah, and he didn't win that Olympic gold medal from luck. He earned it.
Now, this could be a future Olympic medalist right here. Hero defeated Steve Fisher in the last round. Definitely, the main thing with him is he is going bigger than everyone else, but not only is he going big in terms of height, but he's taking it down the pipe, which eliminates the number of hits you can get.
Exactly, that's the only thing right now that's holding Kazuhiro Kokubo back from that first place big money booyah victory spot. Let's watch, he's got perfect rotations, he's got all the tricks, his body is one controlled, rotating, temporary tornado of beauty.
I mean, just the quiet body style right there grabs the whole way on that front side air.
Oh, that McTwist was gigantic. And he goes into the 900, sticks it perfectly. Can he squeeze in a couple more hits?
Oh, my goodness. That was easy 20 feet out.
This is
and
it.
720. Oh. A bit of a butt check right there.
Unbelievable run. Unfortunately, that last crippler seven, when he butt checked coming out of that landing, most people probably didn't even see that, but he actually lost himself some points there from the judges.
Okay, so he sets up the huge nine. Notice how he grabs the whole way in that nine. A lot of the athletes will grab on that last half of the rotation, and then that method was 20 feet out.
Unbelievable, the biggest errors of the day. What happens here towards the bottom? He bones out that big method, and then comes flying into a hello inverted crippler 720, drifts into the flat bottom, and kind of washes on the tranny. Doesn't really fall, but the judges will knock in points for that.
Well, guys, Kokubo, the rags to riches story. He has come through the pre-quals to make it into the final. Can he stand atop the podium? The men's final run when we come back.
This March, it's not how big you are, it's how bad you want it. You take on the best, you fight for the upset, you lay it all on the line. From 64 to the Sweet 16, supplement your local CBS sports coverage of the NCAA tournament with up to 37 games outside your region. Get Mega March Madness from DirecTV for only $49. Call 1-800-GET-SPORTS now or visit DirecTV.com. Mega March Madness, only from DirecTV. You know you want it.
Notice how TV seems to be made for the masses? Showtime Unlimited, on the other hand, seems to be made for Emma. You see, Emma watches the stuff that strikes a chord and speaks to her soul, like this critically acclaimed original series. 4 premium networks on 9 digital channels. Showtime Unlimited, a whole lot to choose from. For Emma and for you. Call 1-800-DIRECTV and add it on for $12 or less per month. Not even the price of a takeout dinner.
Crown Royal on the rocks, please.
You know, they say when you're blind, all your other senses become heightened.
Smooth.
Guys, I think the one on the left likes me.
Introducing Lincoln's newest luxury SUV, Aviator. Equipped from $39,995. See your Lincoln Mercury dealer. There are those who travel and those who travel well.
Welcome back. A look at Stratton Village. You only see a few cars moving because everybody is on the mountain for the men's final of the halfpipe here at the 2003 Phillips U.S. Open Snowboarding Championships. The men have done one run. They have one run to go. And look at those scores, guys. Ross Powers atop with that final run to go. He's got a 2.5-point lead over the Japanese sensation, Kokubo. Remember, Franck fell down, so that's why he has that low score. But you said it during break, J-Mo. If Kokubo had really gotten that last trick in, you think he would have been above Powers.
Yeah, I gotta say that what Kokubo had, that is the one element in snowboarding that you cannot dispute, is he went the biggest. His airs were huge, and he was hauling, sticking the landings, and when you go big, you're number one. You know what I mean? Ultimately, when it comes down to it, it's who goes the biggest.
Well, the one thing, though, that we have seen from the judges today, based on the women's competition, though, is combinations wall to wall, and Ross has the techie spin combinations wall to wall.
So does Kokubo. You know, it's just like, what do you do? I mean, they all got the combinations. It's who's going to be throwing them the biggest and who's not going to make any subtle little mistakes.
That just boils down to mistakes. You're right, J-Mo. Now, speaking of mistakes, Daniel Franck made a mistake in his last run. He has a 14-1 to throw away here. He's going to win it on this run or lose it right now.
Okay, let's watch. Daniel Franck has got that crazy upside-down inverted cripple in 900, setting up with his gigantic backside alley-oop. Tweaked out McTwist. Pretty stock. Here's his setup.
Double pump. Nope. That's it. He double pumped that air to Fakie, lost his balance, and 99 to Daniel Franck. You know what? Daniel is such a rad competitor and a good friend, but he's making me look bad right now because I said at the top of the show that whoever won between Daniel and Shaun was going to win the contest, and Daniel's making me look bad.
Daniel is a fantastic rider. And I hate to say it, but his bib actually came up and covered his eyes.
Did he
right
get bib
there.
Whipped?
He got bib whipped. His number bib came up above his eyes and blinded him. He couldn't see the landing.
And he's talking about it right now. He said, you're right. I just read his lips. He said that my bib went in front of my face.
That is exactly what happened.
J-Mo, you're the man.
I just called it. Daniel's bummed. He's like, man, my bib came up and went over my face. You know what, though? I'm giving huge high fives to Daniel Franck, because his runs in the earlier rounds that brought him
super
here to the
exciting.
Finals were incredible. Daniel Franck, the most experienced guy in this contest right now. He's probably been in 10 or 12 U.S. Opens.
Well, this next guy right here, Ross Powers, has had the highest score of the day. He's sitting on a 38.5. His other run earlier was a 38.3. So,
gigantic backside air. Look at the style in that frontside air. Full grab, bones it out. There's his McTwist, Japan grab. What's going to happen here at the bottom? Flawless 900.
And look at that air to Fakie setup right here. A little bit of a heel biter into that switch McTwist. He's got to get one more big one right here.
Oh, there it is.
Man.
The switch McTwist into the switch, 900. Fakie to fakie, 900 off the last hit.
Again, the combos, okay? That's going to be set, because he had the bigness, J-Mo. You got to give him the bigness in the top of the pipe.
It was actually the same, it was a duplicate run of his first round, except he just did it cleaner. Gigantic backside air right off the top.
How long did he hold that for?
Unbelievable. And then look at this 900. Gets the grab. Keeps his speed. Rolls into the next setup trick, which
Melon
is that
to fakie.
Yeah, stylish. And then switch McTwist.
And then into the fakie to fakie nine.
So slick.
That was really strong.
I mean, and he actually corrected for the wall there, because on that fakie to fakie nine, the pipe was pretty much gone.
And he put it in transition.
Popped it off the lip and nailed it down in the transition. Greg, I love working with you.
Yeah, you know what, J-Mo, it feels all right. The only way that Ross could really improve that is to get the grab on that fakie to fakie nine at the end. Otherwise, I mean, golly, that was an outstanding effort by Ross Powers right there.
So slick. Okay, let's focus right now on little Kokubo.
Kazuhiro Kokubo!
Oh, Kazuhiro Kokubo!
Well, the bummer for Kazuhiro is he has a 36. He's got to beat Ross's 38.5. And that was the first throwaway score. But the thing, he's only 14. Ross is like a competitive veteran.
Yeah.
What's going through the little varmint's mind right now?
I don't know, but whatever it is, I'm sure we can't understand it because his English isn't that good. But I'll tell you, this guy right here, the Japanese pump out style.
He's like you.
Yeah, he's so pumped. This guy, the Japanese in general, when it comes to skating, snowboarding, surfing, have the sickest style ever. Right now, watch Kazubo's spins. It's insane. He's all upside down. The body. Look at that. What are you kidding me? That was unbelievable.
But he didn't get the grab on that.
But I mean, seriously, that 900 was humongous. Can he get? Oh.
Not enough.
People, the crowd is going insane
that
right
was
now.
Epic, but it was not enough.
Kokubo is the crowd favorite. I don't think he's going to be able to take it from Powers because he didn't get the number of hits in. He was missing one more hit, one more trick. He just drifted so far down the pipe, but the crowd loves this kid.
And so do I. That was absolutely epic. But we're talking about $20,000 right now.
But look at that smile. That's a $20,000 smile. I mean, I cannot get over the size of the McTwist. Look at this 900. Ready? Boom! Unbelievable. Connects with the tranny. Perfect. Look how much speed he carries.
And then look at how absolutely huge. Those poles are at 25 feet. He is right up near the top of those poles.
I wish the people out there in TV land right now could hear the crowd. Kokubo is the official crowd favorite. Viva Japan!
We will be back to find out who the winner will be. Will it be Japan or USA, the men's winner, when we return to the Phillips US Open.
Max, you're killing me.
Hey, everybody jamming. Emma, she jamming, and they jamming too. Can a brother get a Bud Light, man?
For the great taste that won't fill you up and never let you down. Make it a Bud Light.
A new, more powerful V8 engine. More distinctive styling. 368 improvements in all. The new 2003 Discovery. It's a whole new way to see the world. From Land Rover, the most well-traveled vehicles on Earth. Nicely equipped from $399 a month. Complimentary scheduled maintenance included.
Listen up, lug nuts. Pop quiz time. What happens to an engine with too much friction? I'll tell you, it loses power. So you want to reduce friction, right, Tinkerbell? This is new Quaker State. Engineered to deliver a 10% lower coefficient of friction. In other words, it's even better than before, because too much friction... Touchy little gearhead, ain't he? Nice haircut. New Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. What more do you need to know? Hey!
This March on OLN, on Global Extremes Mount Everest, tensions rise. As athletes get closer to their goal and must eliminate more team members. Then, the U.S. Open of Snowboarding live. Watch Olympic gold medalist Ross Powers and Kelly Clark air it out, competing with the best in the world. Perry Neese returns, along with a dazzling duo of Paul Sherwin and Bob Rold, to launch our cycling season. And the PBR keeps on kicking. March on OLN.
While we were away, it was official. Ross Powers, the 2003 U.S. Open Halfpipe Champion. He won it in 99. He wins it again in 2003. A very happy man. He was the local favorite. Let's go down to Tina Dixon, who is with our winner.
Ross Powers, you have an Olympic gold medal. You come to Stratton, your home mountain, in front of thousands of fans, riding a good pipe in front of your wife and everything. Is this what snowboarding's all about for you?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, this is the best I've rode all year. It is the place to do it, my home mountain. My family's up here. It was an amazing day for me. I'm so psyched. And winning the Open is huge. After like growing up, coming here, watching it, I'm so excited right now.
How much does this event mean to you? I mean, you have an Olympic gold medal and you won the U.S. Open twice in a row. How much does this mean, you know, compared to all other contests?
This one was huge for me to come back here, like after the Olympics, where everyone always puts some pressure on me, and do it at my home mountain and win the Open. Like, I mean, the Olympic and the Open for me, I put them like together. They're like different formats. The Open's more to the industry. The Olympics is more to like the outside the industry. So winning the Open is huge. I'm so excited.
Well, once again, congratulations.
Oh, thanks so much. Yeah.
Thank you, guys. Well, Tina, great interview. As Ross said, this is for the industry. A lot of history here at the U.S. Open, guys. There you see Ross Powers, the final winner, 38.5. He's the local flavor, but from the land of the rising sun, Kokubo, the adopted son for the day, he gets second. We'll be back after this.
Come, don't slap. Y'all want to be a rock star.
Hey, man.